Yeah, well, we're going to talk about the future of workplace.
Yeah.
Yeah, and that topic is coming back also tomorrow because it's an amazing topic, and we had it also this afternoon. But it's a topic that a lot of people are talking about, the future of offices, the future of how we work in those offices. So it's really a privilege to have the team right now sponsored by Haltion. So it's really an honor to have you with us, Dan, Ken, Dolly.
Super.
Yeah. You have, I guess, a presentation also with you or not?
Yeah, let's try and do a quick few slides just to set the scene. I think it'll help stop me from waffling. I'm going to share my screen. Please tell me if it works.
Yeah, we will tell you.
We have some PowerPoint slides.
I see something.
Yeah, and then we will
perfect.
Round this this session off with a panel together with Leesman and Twitter. So, but first, before we do that, 5 key steps. I see. So that's great.
Yeah,
so,
that's right.
The floor is yours.
Good. Thank you. And I'll really try and keep this to 10 minutes. So I won't go into detail. I'll touch on some things, and if they seem relevant, we can pick them up in the discussion afterwards. But empathic building, which I'm the kind of chief strategy officer of, then we're really focusing on these light digital twins. This is one in a monster hospital in Norway to give you a feeling of what it looks like. And then we're really aiming to kind of focus on end user experience, on employee experience. I'll come back to that in a moment. And then kind of see that as being the gateway to also getting good data to manage buildings. But hey, let's solve real world problems. And then that also gives us the kind of data to manage. So sometimes I like to play a little bit of a demo to give a feeling of the solution. It's a really light digital twin, really easy to use, kind of really intuitive. It was actually built by software developers. I have a background in real estate and construction and data, but the guys who built this were actually a software development company, a big one, who built it for their own headquarters to kind of solve their own problems. And the kind of look and feel and the kind of ease of how it is to be used kind of really comes from that. I don't think, no offense to our industry, I don't think our industry could have done this if it didn't have some game designers and some other guys behind. So touching on some stuff just to kind of really drill down on things that people are already talking about. One of the big reasons to have offices in the future is really for collaboration. I really like what Tenant and Partner in Sweden say, that kind of productivity now, the key element for performance is collaboration. And it's the idea that, you know, face-to-face collaboration is really important, that you can't kind of schedule these innovation sparks, that they happen in kind of beers after work or conversations at a coffee machine or conversations in a corridor or a car park, where you see a director who's really busy and you want to grab them for 2 minutes, or you see someone from a different department that you haven't spoken to in a while, and you say, hey, what are you guys doing? And they talk about something that's really relevant to them. And we even talk about designing for this actually in architecture at the moment. So it's a really key element to have those spontaneous conversations. And then there's another element which we've talked about a lot, and we've done a lot of interviews with human resources directors who really understand the idea of home doesn't work for me. So it's this idea of the bonding and the social interaction. And something has come out called a day tribe, which means even if I was remote working for my entire week, I probably would find a space close to home with a couple of friends or a couple of neighbors and work from that space. So I have, you know, a day tribe, people to hang around with who aren't my family and who I can have lunch with. So even if remote working, we're probably going to shift to something more local from home. And then don't underestimate the elements of just individual reasons why home doesn't work for me, whether it's kind of sick of eating your own kind of microwave food, or I've had some friends tell me their Wi-Fi is terrible, or people wearing stretchy pants all the time, or wanting the kind of exercise. And personally, I feel kind of headspace and inspiration. It's hard to kind of step away while being here all the time. At some of our kind of live events, you know, it's really nice to be in a room with interesting people, with good food and in a beautiful space, and maybe even away from home, and have that headspace. Yeah. But these virtual events are kind of really good now that we can't do those things. But, you know, there's a real value of just home does not work for me, and everyone has their own individual reasons. And I kind of said in our kind of mission statement, we really think that understanding what offices need to become, we really think employee first is the approach. For me, you know, user experience or friction-free workplaces, it's about really saving people time so they can find colleagues or find free desks or see the lunch menu or see the queue in the lunch restaurant. We have restaurants downstairs quite often in Finland. Really just these small kind of irritants and taking them away. And then providing lots of choice of services or even spaces, whether it's concentration rooms or collaboration rooms or phone booths or whatever it is. If we provide the furniture, it's really worthwhile kind of showing where they are as well and showing their availability. So choice is a big thing. And then if we're building solutions, technical solutions, then they need to be super easy to use. They can't just be for the people who really, you know, really adopt smartphones and really have 100 apps on their phone. Empathic Building is built as a web app, so it's really easy to open on a laptop or a touch screen or a tablet or a phone. And that's really around this kind of easy to use element. And then there's a kind of magical ingredient that's hard to talk about as well, which is, if possible, you know, office buildings and kind of really employee first thinking is about help me to be safe, help me to be more healthy, or, you know, to kind of have to really focus on well-being, or, you know, help me to enable me to live a more sustainable lifestyle as well. So there's those options as well that we really see are kind of key elements. And I think from our perspective of really focusing on employee experience and that being the key target, you know, I always kind of come back to this report from the World Green Building Council, and we all know this probably, and the numbers are, you know, are debatable, but essentially a knowledge organization has about 90% of its costs as its staff costs. So let's kind of solve their problems, and then let's use that data to manage. Putting a desk sensor that understands where the free desks are and just uses it for space efficiency calculations and doesn't have this really easy to use kind of beautiful user interface that helps people, for me is a kind of waste of that desk sensor. It's a waste of the investment. So we really kind of have this employee first perspective. And then again, just, you know, if we are deciding that offices need to be something different after people go back to work, then it really is about co-creating with the staff. So really kind of using the desk sensors and the kind of meeting room calendars or desk calendars, displaying it to people in a really easy to use way, but then collecting that data. Sometimes one option is you reserve a desk by just sitting and the sensor reserves it for you. And then keeps it for, let's say, 2 hours after you've left. One example is you can book desks through the user interface or meeting rooms through the user interface. But essentially, the kind of idea of what kind of spaces do we need in the future, we kind of come back to solve the problems and then kind of have this kind of detailed reporting around desk or room utilization or, you know, indoor conditions. And that way, kind of people are voting with their feet and kind of seamlessly voting as to what spaces they want more of and potentially what spaces that are valued less. So we really will start to see, are people coming to the office to do kind of heads down concentration work, or is that something you do somewhere else at home or, you know, in a co-working space or even a library or something closer to home that you don't get in the car or get on the bus or get on your bike to come to the office if you're just going to be concentrating. So, you know, we can really kind of get people to vote with that by seeing what kind of spaces they're booking or what kind of spaces they're sitting at. And then I guess the last thing that it's really hard to know where we're going at this, but just really is understanding the safety elements, maybe having kind of CO2 or TVOC sensors and kind of really looking at the floor plan before we go into a meeting room. Maybe we'll never go into a meeting room again that's kind of full of people's stale air. Maybe we'll have a meeting room booked for 3 p.m. in the afternoon. And the person who's reserved that meeting room will look at the indoor conditions 5 minutes before the meeting. They'll say, oh, that meeting has really high CO2. It's a bit stuffy in there. And they'll move the meeting somewhere else. And, you know, I really see those kind of things happening in future. Especially there's really interesting statistics or research coming around CO2 being really bad for concentration and 800 parts per minute kind of reducing 20% of your ability to think, so your cognitive function. So it may be that we install CO2 and sensors like this to really understand the freshness of air from an airborne pandemic perspective, but that actually it stays for these other things. And then as well, you know, we use the desk sensors as well to kind of inform the cleaning staff as to what spaces have been used that day. But I guess they're the kind of few things from me, you know, collaboration, understanding what actually will get people out of the home, understanding the value of employee first, kind of really understanding how to collect that data to understand what's coming next, and then the really difficult to kind of manage or understand right now, the kind of safety aspect and really what is around the corner. I've gone through that really fast. I wanted to keep to the 10 minutes, and I'm sure we'll have lots of time to open some of that up if necessary in the next while.
Yeah, thank you very much, Ken. That was amazing.
Well done.
Yeah.
I loved that. And I loved, you know, we're going to look back in a few years and say, remember when it was revolutionary to think about the person in the building and to focus on them? I think it's so refreshing to hear so much of that today and really planning with the end in mind, planning with the person in mind. I really loved that part of your presentation. Yeah, well done. Oh, man. Well, do you have any questions?
I'm just happy. It's amazing. So yeah. Thank you very much, Ken, and speak to you soon.